You love music? You admire and enjoy the looseness of jazz? Are you a neophyte who doesn't understand what is this great flavor of jazz that even makes you stay in a quiet room just listening? Or makes you stand up when the Latin rhythms and the percussion just join the party? Then this is your space. This is our space. Enjoy Jazz 101. My name is Amelia Deschamps. Thank you for joining me in this experiment in which we will grow together, learning from this extraordinary rhythm and its exponents. Today I'm privileged to welcome a special artist. He's a jazz guitarist and composer, two times Grammy nominee with more than 20 albums. But he's special also because he's my friend. Welcome, Steve Kahn.
Hi, Amelia. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Steve, I can't start this conversation without telling everyone that the acoustic guitar that they hear in this version of The Duke is your guitar, especially because this version was motivated by this invitation to talk about how jazz sound to you. And I know how much that song and Miles Davis mean to you and to your music, so I am so excited and I'm honored. And yes, we are going to talk about how jazz sound to you, but first, you have to tell us how you decide to become a jazz musician. Because you were playing rock, right? In the 60s and the 70s, that was the flow.
Well, when I started as a kid, I was a rock and roll drummer. I mean, when the Beatles came out, I was in high school and all my friends were playing instruments, you know, mostly guitars and stuff, and I wanted to be a part of it. So drums looked like the easiest thing to do, which is way far from the truth. And so I started playing drums. And then I was in a surfing band, you know, in California. And so of all things, the guys who were in that band, they were the first ones to like play jazz records for me. And I remember they, well, I know they played, they were the first ones to play me Wes Montgomery. So I heard that, and I was still playing drums though. And so as a kid, I used to get on my, well, I guess I had a car by then, and I'd drive into the little town where we were closest to, which then was known as Westwood Village, but it became a really famous place where they have movie premieres and stuff. But when I was a kid in the 50s, early 60s, none of that was there. And so I'd go in and you could buy an LP for $2. So I'd have a $20 bill and I could buy 10 LPs. And I started collecting. And when you...
were searching for jazz music specifically?
Yes, at that time, yes. Mostly, you know, jazz and blues was what I was looking for.
Yeah.
But what, you know, what happens is when you become a jazz fan, you buy a record and you see who's playing, say, bass, drums, and if you like the way that person plays, then you start looking for, well, how many other records is that person on? And then you start buying those records. And one thing leads to another, and here we are sitting in my music room, and there, even though I hardly listen to them anymore, because they've been replaced by CDs, there's 1,000 or so LPs here. And it's all, you know, from that time in my life. But I didn't start playing the guitar until I was 19 years old and I was in college, which is really late. I mean, you have these young virtuosos, you know, start playing when they're 5, 6, 7 years old, and by the time they're a teenager, YouTube, they're, you know, playing all this amazing stuff. But
even though it was like this, I read that Jazz Life magazine named you as one of the 22 all-time greatest jazz guitarists. So, and this was in 98? So,
yeah.
Even though you start like in where you were 19, you learn really fast.
Well, now, you know, my story is, I think, is very similar to a lot of other guys of my generation and younger people too, in one sense, but, you know, most of it is I always felt behind everybody else. Like, I've got to work harder and try and catch up, because everybody else who started playing at 10 years old, they had 9 years more experience than me. They knew more than I did.
You said at the very beginning that we are here in your house. I have the privilege to be at your home. And we are in, this is like your office. We are seeing a lot of LPs. We're seeing a lot of records. And we are in a moment where we are receiving the influence of a lot of music. This is good and this is bad. We can check on the internet a lot of artists that are exploring instruments, rhythms. So you're talking about the influence that you receive. How does jazz looks like for you? Can we hear something, your influence? Who were these artists that from the very beginning you say, like, these are the guys that I want to hear. This is the music that I want to do.
There's so many things we could, you know, that we could choose to play it. This is where it gets difficult, because it's hard to know. I don't think you can play one thing and say, this is what jazz sounds like. If I go through a bunch of different, mention a bunch of different things, you could put on any of them, and to me still, at this stage of my life, it still sounds like jazz. So let's say you could put on a Miles Davis record and listen to him playing, this is the Great Quintet, Prince of Darkness. You can have Wayne Shorter from around the same time period playing something like Speak No Evil. You can have Bill Evans playing, in this famous trio. So the things I'm going to play for you are mostly from a period that's my favorite period. It's between 1958 and basically 1968. There may be something later than that, but it's all from within that period, which is the most special period for me, in sentimentally speaking. So the first thing I thought I'd play, this is the Miles Davis Quintet. The song is Prince of Darkness. Oh, the album is called Sorcerer.
Let's hear it. Why this track specifically?
Well, I just picked, you can choose things by Miles Davis from any number of time periods. They're all different, they're all great. But this period is my favorite of because it's the Great Quintet. You know, Miles Davis, Wayne Shorter, Herbie Hancock, Ron Carter, and Tony Williams. And what they did for me, although I couldn't articulate it as a young person, but it showed me that all great music, it doesn't matter what the genre is, it has two things to me. It has mood and attitude. when it's missing one of those things, to me, it's never really great music. And so what this music is so rich in, I think everything I'm going to play for you is like that. But it has to have mood and attitude. And it, like I said, at 20 years old, I couldn't have said that to you in this way.
Yeah.
But
you didn't know what it was.
No, I couldn't put my finger on why am I responding to this way. And so so the thing is that this became the guiding principle years later for my own recordings. And that's what I'm always trying to do. Whether I achieve that, I don't, you know, who knows.
Mood and attitude.
Yes, those two things. You know, what is it like? Ambiente y actitud, something like that. So, but yes, that's it. But anything I would play for you now is going to have that.
So, but you switch from drums to guitar. What happens with the guitar that called you and said, like, this is what I'm going to play now?
Well, some of it was, you know, a couple things. Wes Montgomery was one, B.B. King, Albert King. I mean, I was hearing all these things, but I also felt like, because I was ignorant about how great a drummer and the drums could be. You know, I thought like, well, I'll be more of a musician if I play the guitar, you know, because it has pitches and notes, even though drums obviously have pitches too. So, but that's what I thought. It was, you know, an extremely ignorant point of view. And it's really funny is, you know, musicians have all these conversations with each other because sometimes when you're making a record, there's all this time where you're sitting around, like especially mixing, like doing nothing. And you're having a conversation with the engineer and stuff. And one of the things my fantasy questions is like, what are the three greatest instruments? And again, if you talk to 100 musicians, they'll all tell you, they'll pick three different things. But mine, as the years have gone by, are the tenor saxophone, the acoustic piano, and drums. Those are the three, to me, the greatest instrument. Because when I listen to the music I love, 90% of it,
you went there.
They have those things in, especially, you know, tenor saxophone and acoustic piano. So, you know, it's kind of a funny thing. But again, back to mood and attitude. Like, for example, I mentioned, you know, Bill Evans before.
Yeah.
So let's play, you know, one of the great trio recordings. I think this is live at the Vanguard. And this is, you know, a beautiful piece that he made many of the things he played famous, even though it's actually a great song with lyrics and everything. So
let's hear it.
Yes. Thank you. So that was Bill Evans, a great pianist, playing Beautiful Love with Scott LaFaro on bass and Paul Motion on drums.
It's piano again.
Yes.
And it's funny because when we were hearing the song, I told you, one of these days I was hearing Bill Evans the whole afternoon. So it's funny that you select his piece.
But what he sort of, you know, brought to the picture in his way was a sense of, you know, the beauty and, you know, a sense of romance about harmony, that harmony, each chordal color is in itself, you know, this work of great beauty. And it's sort of an additional thing to the palette of what jazz is. The other thing is, like a lot of other plays, they sometimes, I think, express this better than I do, but there's a beautiful kind of grace and dignity about Bill and the trio that's also, there's a nobility about it. And these are hard things to achieve. You just can't say, well, I'm gonna have a trio that has elegance, grace, dignity, and nobility. You could say you're going to do that, but it doesn't mean when you sit down to play, it's going to sound like that or feel like that.
Steve, you know, I'm doing documentaries now. So I hear a phrase the other day that attracted to me because in my class, someone says, documentaries are like jazz. It's like, you gotta go with the flow, you have to follow the story, and at the end, everything will make sense. So I'm thinking about like all these artists that we are talking about, and I wanna know how loose can you go when you're playing a song, when you're hearing a jazz session, when you're playing as a musician. This is like one of the most beautiful things about jazz is that the artist can improvise in front of everybody, but how loose can you go, and if you don't get lost in it, or can you repeat yourself once you start doing this like a job, like a professional artist? Every piece, how do you manage to do it different every single day?
Okay, this is a great question, and my answer is not so simple, but I want to address each point that you made. So firstly, the first part of your story, when you said you were talking to somebody and they described, you know, like making a documentary is like jazz. Well, anytime people, you know, talk about jazz or what is it and this and that, I always think about this story. It was a joke. It was always like really funny. And it's also about men and women, about lots of things, but it's about jazz. And so a guy, this is the joke. So a guy is, he and his girlfriend are going to do something. Let's say Friday night, Saturday night, something. And they can't figure out what to do. And so the guy, after thinking, you know, he says to her, I've got it. Let's go hear some jazz. And she looks at him like with a strange, quizzical look on her face, and she says, jazz, isn't that music that sounds like 1,000 rats running around all at the same time and they don't know where they're going? And of course, this to me was always really funny, because that's oftentimes, it's not just a joke about women, it's a joke about people who don't listen to jazz, that's what they think it is. You know, 1,000 mice running around as fast as they can, at seemingly not knowing where they're going. And so that makes it, you know, kind of a funny, at least to musicians, you know, a funny joke. But the same thing could happen if two guys are talking and the guy says the other one. The result could be the same. But, for example, after years, you know, jazz, you know, has been around, I don't know, a century, more than a century. And so, you know, a lot of it involves people playing what we call standards, you know, great, they call the American songbook, you know, songs from Broadway shows and movie themes, but jazz guys took them and loosened them up and stretched them out. But the thing is about these songs is the approach was very much the same. These songs are usually 32 bars, and they're in a form, AA, BA, or AA prime, one of these two things. And so eventually, everybody arrived at a point where they're saying, like, you know, we've done this. You know, you play the melody, then, you know, this guy solos for a billion choruses, then this guy solos, same form, over and over and over again. And the players are enjoying it, but there's something very repetitious about it. So as the evolution of the music went along, guys were trying to say, this is part of the answer to your question, is that, yeah, like, how do we loosen this up? How do we stretch this, the boundaries of this, so it's not so formulaic, so rigid, that you do this, 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 and this, and it's always the same. And so you had various breakthroughs in the history of the music. You know, what Miles was doing from that period that I played you, where we played Prince of Darkness. But what I'd like to play for you now, this is the great Ornette Coleman Quartet. And let's listen to a bit of that, and I'll explain to you what was so innovative about this that changed the way all of us think about music. So that was the great Ornette Coleman Quartet playing Chronology, which I believe was with Ornette on alto sax, Don Cherry on trumpet, Charlie Hayden on acoustic bass, and I don't remember whether that's Ed Blackwell or Billy Higgins on drums. But the thing is about that music that he was playing, you know, a lot of people thought, this is, forgive my language here, you know, this is bullshit. This is not, he's not playing like the traditional jazz guys, you know. Or they'd say, well, it's out of tune. They're not playing together. You know, this doesn't make any sense. But the thing was, you know, I read his, many years ago, I read his biography. And it was, it also was really, you know, oops, life-changing to read about his life. And I think, I don't remember what it was, whether he was, you know, dyslexic, something, you know, where it's like your mind arranges things in a different way. And so who's to say that that wasn't a part of how his music ended up sounding mm-hmm. like that. But the other thing was, you know, he had experiencing all the horrible racism in this country, all the shit he had to go through was really horrible. Awful. And to end up being, you know, one of the greatest innovators in our music. But what he did was, he was using, in his mind, you know, traditional forms, you know, blues, rhythm changes, all these things, but they didn't sound like that. And what it sort of launched was this period for the younger players where you would be having jam sessions together And instead of playing a standard, somebody say, let's just play, time no changes.
Meaning there's a pulse. Okay.
And you're just, you know, basically flying with what's going on. And it's hard to say, well, that was good, that was bad. Whatever happened in those 10 minutes you were playing, 20 minutes, whatever it is, that's what it was, and you let it go. The bad thing, some ways, about records is a performance on a record lives forever. So people associate that with that's what that piece is. But no, that's what that piece was in that moment. You know, 2 weeks later, it's something completely different.
Yeah, I was wondering, like, when I hear one of your compositions, I heard you, like, in your records, but I've seen you live. How much of it is, like, what you have in the record, what is in the CD, or how loose can you go on the stage? You just go away and do whatever you want in the stage, or you go back to what you record?
Well, first of all, you know, it really depends on the environment, the musical environment you find yourself in. So,
yeah.
I always want things to feel like they're as loose as possible, but it doesn't always happen that way. And when you're, because musicians need
connection,
a structure, something to that we're all tied. That ties us together.
Yeah.
Now, sometimes that something can be like, we're going to play with no structure. So that's the structure. There's nothing.
Okay. You feel free that day, right?
If you're going to play that way. But it's you have to be with people who are not afraid to go someplace where they don't understand where they are. And that's the thing.
To be able to come back, because there's a moment where you have to assemble the thing.
You sort of have to come back
or
to somewhere.
Or you will hear the mice going everywhere.
Well, yes, well, but that's why you have to have, sometimes, you start with a theme. It can be just some little fragment. And usually, because it's our nature to have sort of a form where you start with something, you can explore it, and then you come back to it, and there's an ending. Things just don't go on forever. Records, you can sort of do that. You can have a fade where it just keeps, it kept going, and somebody has to, you know, an engineer has to go and stop it. But it's a very fine line between, you want to be, I think, feel free within structure. And that's also what helps you to sort of break out of that structure. Let's just take another example here. This is now from some years later, but this is a Chicoria trio playing an Ornette Coleman tune. This is him playing Blues Connotation.
Remember, this is Jazz 101. My name is Amelia Deschamps, and I am speaking with Steve Kahn, jazz guitarist and composer, also a Grammy Award nominee. We'll be right back. So that's Chick Corea.
Yes, and this is with Dave Holland and Barry Altschul. You know, one of the best, you know, freer jazz piano trios. This is just before he started the whole, you know, all the Return to Forever stuff. So he was in this place, and I think, you know, if you take the title of the song, just Blues Connotation, it's an abstraction of a blues, except, you know, it is and it's not. And so everything can be as elongated, you know, in a blues, yeah, it's 12 bars. So, you know, the first four bars are the one chord, the next two bars are the four, etc. And it's the same form. But here, like the song itself, it's 13 bars long. So that's weird. But so some guys have traditionally played the tune, well, this is going to be a 13 bar blues. But then other guys say, no,
that's you, not. You know that you're talking musician way,
yes,
right now.
But that's okay. It's that's what other way, you know. But I'm speaking of it as this abstraction. In other words, you can have something that says it's this number of bars, but you were talking before about being free, breaking those things. You go where you need to go. And so that's what is happening there. Ornette was doing it anyway. When Ornette was doing that, he was like 57 through, you know, 60, early 60. It's way before other people said to themselves, you know, later in the decade of the 60s, like, wait a minute, this guy, he had it. He knew where this was all headed before we did. And so that's what was so beautiful about it.
You said a few words in Spanish, switching the topic. You said a few words in Spanish when we were starting this conversation. I am a Dominican, I'm trying to speak English. I hope you're understanding anything that I'm saying here, or I hope you enjoy this conversation and the music we are hearing, because I know that is not the best English. But you speak Spanish, and you speak Spanish very well, and you understand Spanish very well. And I know that you live in the Caribbean zone, in Venezuela, for a time. Can we talk about fusion, jazz, and how this period or this experience has an impact in your music? And maybe to understand how does jazz work from this perspective?
Well, I think, you know, the amazing thing is that if you think that you're doing something new, that's probably your first mistake. Because the truth is, like, whatever ideas you're thinking of, somebody probably did it something like that 20 years ago. It's just you didn't know it. And so the whole, you know, fusion era, which I was a part of, not because a bunch of us sat together in a dark room, conspiring to fuse musics together, but things had already been happening like that. Guys were doing records with Indian musicians. Guys were doing records with Brazilian musicians. All kinds of things had already happened. It's just nobody paid attention to them, but they had happened already. So when the way I see the history of it, somewhere around 1967, 68, this is to me, historically speaking, when the fusion era, as we know it, began. And I think there were sort of three, in my view, three, maybe four groups that were really responsible for this. One was Miles Davis going electric, which started, I think, Miles in the Sky, where he told Herbie Hancock, oh, here's the Fender Rhodes, you're going to play that on this record. And so that was one thing. Then you had the Gary Burton Quartet with Larry Coryell on guitar, Steve Swallow on bass, Roy Haynes on drums. And this is where also everything, Larry Coryell, I think, was really kind of the first fusion guitarist, you know, mixing jazz and blues and rock and all that, but in a very, you know, wonderful jazz context. Then you had the experimental group, the Charles Lloyd Quartet, which was Charles Lloyd, Keith Jarrett, Ron McClure, Cecil McBee, and Jack DeJohnette on drums. And so that was also, you know, a very forward-looking kind of music. And I'm forgetting one of the really important thing, but this is all like around 67, 68. And so then, like for me, you had a bunch of like young musicians who were already here in New York doing these kinds of things, fusing stuff together. And when I got here in 1970, I thought I was going to be, I wanted to be the next Wes Montgomery. That was my dream. And I got here and I found out nobody wanted to hear that. Everybody was in another place and they didn't want to hear guitar like that at that moment. They wanted electric bass and an electric guitar doing, you know, crazier things and a mixture of, you know, jazz and rock and blues and R&B. So the thing was, I'd already been listening to all that stuff, so it was shocking, but making that switch wasn't that hard because my instincts could, I could do all those things. But it wasn't, I didn't plan to do that. We just fell in together. I mean, you can't plan, you know, sort of who you're going to come here with at the same time. But there I was with the Brecker brothers and David Sanborn and Don Grolnick and Willie and Steve Gadd, Mike Minieri, I can't even name all of them, all these wonderful players. And we were all of a mind about doing something. You're trying, again, it's still all about the same thing. You're trying to find a way to do something different. In my development as a player, there are three records, and I'd like to play you little pieces of the three of them that showed me, I didn't realize what I was listening to, but really touched me deeply, but also showed me that, like, it's possible to be playing like Latin music and be so free that you can't even imagine what's possible. And so the first record, the thing I want to play for you, this is Herbie Hancock. And this is 19, I believe, is it 63? So somewhere between 63, 64, 65. And this is a record nobody paid any attention to because they didn't recognize any other famous names other than Paul Chambers is on bass. But they see Willie Bobo playing drum set, but Willie's one of the great timbaleros of all time. This is a piece from his album, a Blue Note album, Inventions and Dimensions. It's called Succotash. So what you just heard is so fascinating to me on so many levels. Because one, you know, Herbie Hancock, he's such a musical person, he can do anything. But here he is exploring Latin rhythms in a very free way. Because he writes about it in the liner notes to the record. He says, I came in, I didn't have any real formal written music for this album. I had some ideas. and we just played. And when I read that, it was a very freeing thing. Like, it said to me, this is possible. And that meant a lot to me, even though I wasn't, you know, as evolved as you need to be to do that. But there are other things at play here. So what Willie Bobo, who's, again, one of the greatest Latin percussionists ever, he's one of my heroes. I used to go see his bands play when they came to LA. But Willie's a timbalero, one of the greatest. And so he's also one of the reasons that convinced me I'll never be a good drummer. Because I used to sit in the front row of the audience and watch his right hand playing the mambo bell. I go, oh my God, I can't play anything that fast. It was amazing. But you have to look at, when you look at a lot of jazz records, almost all of them, they're produced by these white guys. And these white guys, as well-meaning as their intentions were about jazz, Latin music, etc., they're coming from it at a perspective where they don't understand certain sounds. And certain Latin sounds make them like panic, like as if, I don't know what to do with this. Like cowbells, cascara on the sides of the timbal. So some of the greatest Latin jazz records have no cascara, no cowbells, anywhere.
Really?
And yet they're considered great Latin jazz records. And why? Because these producers, like when the guys, the Latin percussionists, would follow their instincts, they say, whoa, stop. Can you do something else? Well, I could do this. No, something else. And finally, you know, a cymbal is an acceptable sound. So here you have Willie Bobo, who obviously he knows what the right thing to do is, but the producer is looking at it and he's playing an abacua pattern, which is normally played on the checkere, but he's playing it on the snare drum with brushes. And on that record of Herbie Hancock, there's no cowbell anywhere and there's no cascara. And I know Willie would have done that. But those were like unacceptable sounds to white producers.
Okay.
So you have that element going on. But that's not what's important. What was really important is just how free Herbie approached playing this music. And it was really inspiring to me, even though I didn't know what I was hearing, what was going on, what he was doing. And the amazing thing is, on my more recent records, I always try to do something that does something interesting with Afro-Cuban 6/8, where I'm sort of twisting around something. And some of the percussionists, they look at me and say, like, what? You know, and I said, trust me, this is going to work. And so, but again, it's a fusion of things I hear with what I feel is sort of traditional. Now, let's take a look at something else. This now is from one of the most famous Latin jazz records. It's an album by Cal Jader, the vibraphonist. This is from 1966. But this had a very unknown young musician named Chick Corea playing piano. And on this record, the way Chick played, it was like nobody heard somebody playing like Latin music like that.
In that way.
Because it's so free and adventurous, and yet there's structure, the Latin rhythms are the same. Like I said, the only thing that's different, you're never going to hear a cowbell, you're never going to hear a cascara, because those sounds to the white producer, those were too much to deal with. So now I'm going to play you this piece. It's a short one, but everything on that album to me is just classic. It's great. This is called Descarga Cubana, and it's a famous song. I think Cachal wrote it, but it's just, you know, it's a jam, but it's a montuno, just over. But if you listen to what Chick plays, it's really remarkable, and again, in its way, very free. Thank you. So when I heard that, I said to myself, that's how I want to play the guitar, believe it or not. And that, again, I wasn't ready to do that, not even...
We were talking about...
This record is in 1966.
66.
So I haven't moved here yet. I guess I've just started college.
Okay.
And I maybe just started to play the guitar. Yeah, 66 is when I started. But I there's something about that I heard that I said, I don't know if you can do it, but that's how I want to play guitar. And so when you listen to these last four records of mine, it's a process of trying to get closer to that. But even going back, I don't know, another 10, 15 years, I was still working at the same thing.
Yeah.
So that's one thing. Now,
I have a question for you.
Yes.
Related to that. Because, yes, we have to talk about your last four records, because I know they are related. But before that, talking about this Latin music, we have an experience that I want to tell the audience. Remember, we are talking here in Jazz 101, and we are talking to Steve Kahn. Steve, we have an experience together. This is how I remember it. I'm Dominican, right? I said it before, and as Dominican, we have like the rhythm in our veins, kind of. There are exceptions, but these are exceptions. And I remember once you went to the Dominican Republic for vacation, and I took you to a baseball game. Also, as a Dominican, I have to know what a baseball game is. And I remember that in the middle, from one inning to the other, we are used to hang out, dance, salsa, merengue. And my friends and I, we start dancing, and we start doing this. And suddenly, you say, stop. And I say, like, what? And then you said, do it again. And the music was playing, and we start doing again. And then you say, stop. And for me, I have never forget that situation, because we said, like, what is it? And you said, like, come on, guys. How do you do it? I have to go to school to learn how to do that. For us, that's la clave, right? So
right.
What is it about it? Because every time we hear like a salsa, we do it, but it's a natural thing. So what about it? Why it was such a thing at that moment?
No, I think it had been a fascination for me long before that. You have to remember, you know, my dear ex-wife, Nancy, is Puerto Rican. So... you know, not that Nancy was a big salsa fan, she wasn't, but having spent so much time in Puerto Rico, I started to, you know, again, reconnect in a whole other way with Latin music. And then after our divorce, I started going to one of our most famous salsa clubs here, the Latin Quarter, which is just was on Broadway between 95th and 96th. And I would go there just to hang out and see all the great soneros and their bands and everything. And of course, watch the girls dancing, which was unbelievable. But as all the songs would come on, everybody immediately heard what the clave was. And so at the same time, I'm also spending time downtown at this club. I'm spacing on the name of the club, but they had live bands and they were playing all the best salsa records. And one of the musicians who helped me a lot is a bass player, Bernie Minoso, and we always said here Minoso, but yeah. Bernie was a bass player, and he was really incredibly talented and knowledgeable about Latin music. And I asked him the same thing. This is in the 90s, way before I met you. And I'm saying, like, how do you know? And we must have spent 2 years. He says, man, you know, you just know. You just hear it. You feel it. But for a Blanquito, you know, this is not helpful. Because, you know, once I got it, I mean, I knew what it was. But... So one day he says...
So my surprise was when you said that, because for us, it was a natural thing.
Yes, and it should be. I mean, you've been listening to this music in your house your whole life, so it should be natural.
Yeah.
So one day, Bernie and I are talking, and I keep asking him. This is after endless nights of sitting there in this place, listening to all this great music, and going and buying CDs, salsa CDs, everything, catching up on the history, doing everything I could. It still wasn't helping me. And so one night, Bernie says to me, he says, you know, the clave doesn't dictate the song. The song dictates the clave. He says, when you hear the vocal and you hear the inflection, you get to the coro, it tells you what the clave is. It's telling you what it is. It isn't something you say, I'm going to write a piece of music in 3-2 because that's what I want to do. That's not the way it goes. So that was the first thing that was really helpful to like turn around my perspective. Then he says, okay, think of it this way. He said, listen to the horns playing. And where do you hear the 3-bar? The bar that goes da, da, da. You know, for the ending, you know, ding, da, da, ding, da, da, ding, and you have a break. Bum, bum, bum. That tells you where the 3, so if it's on the other side, then it's in 2-3. If it's on the front side of it, then it's in 3-2. So that was really helpful. Then he said, the same thing, like, listen to the coro. Wherever you hear the 3-bar, that tells you, you know, which of the claves it is. You know, there are like 4, I think. You know, there's 2-3, 2-3 rumba clave, and 3-2, and 3-2 rumba clave. So, you know, I learned all those things. I used to sit here and do these exercises, tapping out the clave. One great musician, Bob Franceschini, he said to me, if you really want to understand this, you have to learn how to tap the cascara with your right hand and the clave with your left hand. So I used to sit in the movies and go, and then I'd reverse it. He says, you got to switch hands. Some people would think I was nuts in the movie theater, but I was practicing like all the time because I wanted to know. And then finally, the last, if there's a trick, which I don't think it is, because sometimes the campana, which the bongocero plays, doesn't come in oftentimes till later in a song. But he says, you can always tell what the clave is by the campana pattern. So if he's playing, that's 2-3. Dun, 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 dun. If it's the other way, boom, beep, boom, beep, boom, beep, boom, beep, boom, then it's 3-2. And the second I learned that, I went, I'm never lost. So, you know, it was an amazing process of learning. But when you're hungry to learn, like you feel like I'm out of it. You know, they're speaking a language I can't understand. And on a certain level, I know I'll never understand all of it, no matter how much I study and practice all this other stuff. I'm not a Latino. That's, forget it. But you can learn enough to function in the music and have guys respect your perspective on things, even if it's not what they would do. So this is from 1965 also.
Okay.
And this is a Jazz Crusaders record when they were still the Jazz Crusaders, not the Crusaders. And they made a record called Chile con Sol. And on this record, Claire Fisher did all the arrangements for them, who's also one of my heroes. And this is a tune piece called The Latin Bit. But this record, unlike the things I was hearing from New York, it has everything. It has cascara, it has the mambo bell, it has the cha-cha, the whole thing, everything.
So this is Latin?
Yes, this is
Latin jazz.
This is Latin jazz, you know, of a certain kind.
So we can do La Clave with that song?
You should be able to. Hold on. We'll be right back.
So that was Chile con Sol. We can hear all the Latin rhythms.
That tune is called The Latin Bit. It's from, the album is called Chile con Sol.
Oh, Chile con Sol is the album.
Yes.
Yeah, and we were doing la clave here, so we can understand that this is really Latin music in jazz. And I was talking to you before about this Caribbean jazz project, and there is a song that, a composition that you did that I really love. I enjoy it a lot because I used to work very early in the morning. I have to wake up like at 4. So sometimes I need like a reboot and I have to take some energy. And I used to play this song in my car. So why don't we hear Descarga Canelón?
Okay.
Would you like it?
If we must, sure.
Let's hear it.
Okay.
Evolution in your music, like I've heard a lot. I have the opportunity to hear a lot of your music, and I can see like from Got My Mental to the albums that you are doing now, it's like you're evolving, you're changing as an artist. There's a lot of bolero.
Yes.
In the base of your music. Can you talk about it? How have you been evolving as an artist, and why this influence of bolero also in the last records you are using it a lot?
Well, yes, in the last four records there's always at least a bolero. And for me, apart from its rhythmic content, to me it's still a ballad. And so as we were talking about an album as a whole picture, you know, like a film. It's a story from beginning to end. I can't make a record without a ballad. There has to be something, a work that's, you know, more dedicated to beauty. And so if I'm making a Latin jazz record, then it's going to be a bolero. So, you know, I've also tried to do interesting things within what is a bolero. Like, for example, on the last record, we did something that was very unusual. We played a bolero in 3/4. And the guys looked at me like I was crazy. You know, because Latin music is so much based on patterns. And when a pattern doesn't immediately come to mind that fits with what you're going to do, guys go like, wow, they have to have a meeting together about what they're going to do with it. So patchwork, that tune is called Bouquet. So it's a bolero in three. And which is something that I love doing. And recently, I did a special arrangement of after Chicoria passed away.
Oh, I was going to ask about it. So
yes, it's a piece of his called "Bleeding Orchid" that very few people know. It's only been on one record, a Joe Farrell record called "Outback" on CTI from 1971. And I always loved this piece of music. And, you know, when Chick passed away, I just felt like this is a chance to say thank you to him for everything he gave to me. I never really spent much time with him. He's not my friend, none of that. But his music meant a lot to me. Again, mostly the acoustic piano stuff. And so I did an arrangement of this piece. And, you know, when you're doing something, and sometimes a bolero can flow into a cha-cha-cha. And so the musicians you're playing with, they always joke about this and say, yeah, it's a bolero cha. So, you know, so we utilize both things. But again, it's a bolero in three. And one of the other things that I also like to do with the bolero is one of my favorite conga patterns is called an afro. And I always relate to it as it feels something like this to me. Boom, patiti, boom, boom, pep, boom, patiti, boom, boom, pep. That's what the afro is, and so, at least to me. And so, when you combine that in the context of a bolero, it gives it a different feeling. But, I mean, the guys weren't, they had no problem doing that. I mean, that, they said, yeah, sure, we can do that. So, there are all these little things. Then, like, you were just talking about ballads, like on the backlog record, the one before Patchwork. We did a ballad, but I didn't do it as a we did two ballads. Our Town, which is my father's song, is a bolero. And then there's Emily, which is one of my favorite, you know, ballads of all time. But we played it in 6/8 as a ballad. So it's got the Afro-Cuban, all those rhythms with the cowbell and a ballad, at which most people would never do. But like, I like those sounds, and it can still be a ballad to me. So I'm always trying to find interesting ways of using all the things that are beautiful to me, sounds, etc., feelings, feels in the ritmo, on these records. And so it's full of those things.
Let's hear one of them.
Okay, well, let's do Bouquet. Thank you.
So we hear bouquet. And in your career, there are a few people that I can see in a lot of your records, like John Patitucci, Jacques Dejeuner, Mark Quiñones. What they add to your music? Why them? It's like, it looks like your team.
Well, I think the thing is that, you know, when you're making a record together, you know how people, because it gets more like exposure on YouTube and stuff, you know, where people on a TV show or they make a movie together and they'll say things like, oh, we're a family, we love each other, all this stuff. But you're a family for that period of time. Then everybody goes their separate way, and in a way they may carry warm feelings for that experience, but it's over. And then they're off to do their own thing, whatever that may be. So, in a sense, I have warm feelings about all the guys I play with, but in the end, it was just a compact amount of time. That's all it is. We come together, work as hard as we can. I know those guys give everything to what they're doing, but in the end, they're off doing their own thing. I'm not important to them in that way. But if you look at the bigger thing about your question is, in my recording life, I don't know why this is, but I seem to do things in threes. I don't know why, but like my first three albums, Tightrope, The Blue Man, and Arrows from 77, 78, 79, on all those records, Randy Brecker, Michael Brecker, David Sanborn, Don Grolnick, Will Lee, Steve Gadd, Rick Murata, Rob Mounsey. It's like a family of players. And we did these records together because they were the important pieces, Jeff Mironoff too, to realize that music that I was playing then. Skip ahead, 1981, 82, 83. Three Eyewitness records together. Me, Anthony Jackson, Steve Jordan on drums, and Manolo Badrena. And that music probably changed my life. Those maybe, for me, three most important records because of where they took me. I owe those three guys everything. I mean, all the players I play with, I owe them it. But what that did for me personally, I can't even begin to express. So then you go through another chunk of time. Then I go and I do two records with Al Foster and Ron Carter. So it wasn't three, it was two. And in between that, I came back with Anthony, Manolo, and this time Dave Weckl. Then the record we were just talking about, Crossings, that brought in Dennis Chambers to other family of players. Anthony, Manolo, Dennis, and we became a family. And that extends to today. I'm still playing with Dennis. Anthony, I would be, except, you know, circumstances kind of ended up preventing that. But so I did three records with John and Jack, but they were spaced out. 96 was got my mental. Then I didn't play with them again until 2005. So it's almost 10 years later.
Wow, yeah.
And then we did The Greenfield and Borrowed Time. So those are the three records with them.
With them.
But like you mentioned Mark Quiñones, and I can't mention Mark without, you know, saying Bobby Allende and Ruben Rodriguez too. So those three guys, they're like, you know, my brothers, my teachers. I see that, you know, I've learned so much from them about music, Latin music. You know, I love those guys. And we've been playing together since the 90s, when I was lucky enough to, you know, be introduced to them. And Oscar Hernandez introduced me to those guys, the great keyboard player, leader of the Spanish Harlem Orchestra, and a million things. Oscar's, you know, a giant in Latin music.
So what I'm seeing is like this little family that is growing from one, and from time to time, there's one person, one new person, but it's like this group of people that understand each other and create music together. And at the end,
yes, and I think they know.
Like your pot.
Yeah, they have an intuitive sense of, like, you know, I think whether we argue or not, you know, I think they like me and they respect that I'm really trying my best to try to do something that's important to me. And they work really hard to help make the vision come alive, because I can make really good sounding demos, and I use Mark's Quiñones' samples to do these demos. So it's kind of funny to hear himself before we do it. But then they have other ideas at the session or the rehearsal, and they change things from the rhythmic perspective. And Ruben is like a voice of calm. So I love working with those guys. The only reason that you see personnel changes, like seeing these four records on backlog, Dennis wasn't available. So Mark Walker played drums and did a fantastic job. But otherwise, Dennis would have been on all of them.
So we are in the final part of our conversation, and really I want to talk about these four records that you said that they're like a sequence.
Yes, they're all connected.
Well, we are talking about Parting Shot.
Parting Shot, Subtext,
Backlog, and Patchwork. That is 2019.
Right.
Yeah. So why you consider them like I don't know if it is a sequence. Why you consider they should be heard like as something related?
What's really different about it is you're hearing Latin jazz where the guitar, almost unlike ever before, is really the principal instrument. It's playing all the melodies, it's playing solos, it's doing these things, whereas in the history of Latin music, the principal instruments, you know, are of course the piano, the trumpet, the trombone, the violin, the flute. I'm skipping the percussion, but in terms of melodic content, these are the sounds you expect to hear. You never hear a guitar. Yes, you hear a tres here and there, but not as a melody instrument. So my goal with these four records was to make a place for the guitar, what the guitar can do in the context of the same rhythms, sounds, you know, playing the kinds of tunes I like to play, which are not the tunes necessarily everybody would choose to play, and to say, wow, I can do this. That any guitarist listening to the record say, I can do this. And my hope, this is my cosmic dream with this stuff, was that, like, I know pretty much personally, and if not personally, I know of them. I know all of the great Latino virtuoso guitar players. I know all of them. And they're virtuosos. They're fantastic. But all of them, they don't want to play Latin music. They don't want to play with Latin rhythms. They want to play some kind of fusion music. Or they want to play abstract guitar trio music, and which is fine. You know, they should go ahead and do that. But the point is, if I inspire some young kid out there, whether it's in República Dominicana, Colombia, Venezuela, Argentina, Chile, Puerto Rico, it doesn't matter where, but if I inspire some kid to say, well, I can do what Steve Kahn was doing, and I can do it better, then I would be so happy, because as you're sitting here, you feel all these rhythms inside. That's what, you know, those are intuitive things for them. So they should be able to do it better than what I did. But we'll see. I may not be around, I may not live long enough to see it, but that was my hope contained in the cosmic message inside these four records.
So what are we going to hear from that bunch of records? I want you to pick one song that can help us understand what you're trying to transmit.
Okay. So first of all, my apologies to everyone. It's really impossible to pick one song from four records and say this says it. But I chose to present an old Joe Henderson tune from 1965 or 66 from his album, which is called Mode for Joe. And the song is called A Shade of Jade. And again, this is one of those songs that had our conversation gone a different way, it would have been in the presentation, because it's part of when you originally asked me about, you know, doing a podcast with you, and you said, I want to understand to you, like, what does jazz sound like? So when I hear Joe Henderson playing his own composition, A Shade of Jade, to me, I said, that sounds like jazz to me. So this is my interpretation of that song. Features Randy Brecker and the band we've already discussed. And we did something interesting with it where Randy is playing all three of the horn parts himself, that on Joe Henderson's version were played by trumpet, tenor, and trombone. So it gives a more brassy touch to the album, which is a big part of Latin jazz. And if you ask me, you say, well, Steve, do you have a regret about these records? Is something you miss doing? I would tell you, yeah, I wish, I'd been able to afford to have had like brass, whether it's two trumpets, two trombones, whatever it is, on the records, because that's so much a part of Latin music. But, you know, but on this tune, we have that. So that kind of ties together everything we've, you know, been talking about from the beginning to this.
So with this song, we will end this episode of Jazz 101. Steve, thank you very much for joining me in this conversation. I hope you enjoyed as much as I did, and I hope the audience too enjoy it. And remember, this is Jazz 101. I am Amelia Deschamps. See you the next time. Be kind and hear jazz. Let's hear A Shade of Jade. Thank you, Steve.
Gracias, Amelia.
Gracias, Steve.